Hello everyone, I welcome you back for lecture 2 of module 2 under voltage sag and interruption. So we have already learned in module 1. So before I go for this lecture 2, let me introduce myself again. I am Sushmita Sarkar, assistant professor in triple department of RV College of Engineering, Bangalore. So in this particular lecture, we will be learning more about estimating the voltage sag performance. In last lecture, we have mainly concentrated on the sources behind the voltage sags and the interruptions. And here we'll be talking about more on the estimating that particular sag. So, you know, without estimating, we cannot think about any solution, proper solution, specifically when the solution, whether the solution will be economically or not. Any design or any solution should sound economical. So what is the tagline I have put it? That is, without reliable estimates, system will be challenged. Fine. So keeping this thing in mind, we will come across these particular points and we will learn at the end of this lecture. That is, we'll exactly come to know how to estimate the voltage sag performances, you know, by the methods which we call as area of vulnerability, then equipment sensitivity to voltage sags. Then the sags can be performed at the transmission end as well as at the distribution ends. So if your customers can be connected in transmission distribution both, so if the customer is connected towards the distribution end, then this at the distribution end, as we have discussed in our last lecture also, can be from the same feeder or can be from the parallel feeders. Okay, so we'll check exactly how these disturbances impact on the voltage sag at the utility end. So to start with, so the voltage sag performance, we know that to estimate this particular voltage sag at the customer end, it's very, very important, you know, because to understand the voltage performance of the supply system, to facilitate the design of the, because until unless you don't have an idea of what can be the estimated voltage sag, the equipment cannot be designed in that particular way. You know, equipments are very sensitive to the sags and they may trip off without, you know, they may fail to operate or they trip it with a which is not at all required. So the tripping should not happen unnecessarily. So keeping, so these things are very important for the design of equipment sensitivity, you know. So therefore, we say that it is important to understand the expected voltage sag performance of the supply system so that facilities can be designed and equipment specification developed to assure the optimum operation of the production facilities. So your all the equipment should be operated optimally. For that, the voltage, the minimum voltage or the voltage sag which the equipment is going to face should be known. So the following is a general procedure for working that what is the procedure to get these estimated voltages. For that, this is the following procedures which usually will be followed by industrial customers to assure the compatibility between the characteristics and the operation. Fine. So what is the first thing? The very first point, we should know that what is the number of sags are going to take place and what are the characteristics of these individual sags. You know, so these two are very important in case of a transmission end. So what is the first point talks about? Find out the numbers and characteristics of voltage sags that results from the transmission end fault. So that is the first step. Second step will be the same, find out the number of faults and characteristics of the voltage sag that results from the distribution end. So we should have an idea how many faults are taking place from the transmission end as well as from the distribution end and what are the characteristics of these individual faults, you know. So once you know these type of faults, the characteristics and the number of faults which are taking place at both the ends, then you will be able to design your equipments. So the point number three talks about the sensitivity of the equipment. So determine the equipment sensitivity to voltage sags. So this will determine the actual performance of the production process based on voltage sag performance calculated in your previous two steps. Fine. Now once your step number three is done, then what do you think about? You think about what is my optimal solution, you know? So you need to evaluate your optimal solution that could improve the performance either on the supply end or at the distribution end. So that is what the four steps we should keep it in mind before we go towards the calculation or estimating the voltage sag performance. Okay. I just repeat, number one, find out the number of sags and the characteristics of the sags at the transmission end, the same point at the distribution end. And once you know the number of faults and the sags and the characteristics of the sag at both transmission and distribution end, these two data will help you to design the sensitivity of the equipment to withstand this particular sag. Once you know that, then you come out with the strategic ideas, what is the optimal solution which can be attained to improve the performance of the system either at the supply end or at the utility end, right? Now, very important and very interesting topic is something called as area of vulnerability. Okay, so what is this topic of area of vulnerability? You know, so for an example, in a simple English and a simple example, so if there is a fault at a particular point, whether the fault has taken place at the transmission end or whether it has taken at your substation point or at the utility end, you know. So if there is a fault has taken place at that particular point, what is the area that this fault is going to put its effect? You know, what are the boundaries, the miles of the exposure to this fault, okay, which will be getting affected by the fault at a particular location? So what does it define in a proper language, technical language? That is, the vulnerability is the ability of the network continuing to provide, you know. So it, and the concept of vulnerability only comes when you are talking about, you know, below point per unit, because how do we define a voltage sag? A system is operating between 0.1 to 0.9 per unit, we define as a sag. So when it is going below that minimum write through capability, which is your, you know, 0.1 per unit, then the concept and your system is, your equipment is able to withstand that, then it is called as, you know, it is very designed, perfectly designed equipment. And it's, even though it is below that minimum write through capability, still the system is operating without any misoperation or malfunctioning or, you know, interruption of the system. So what we are talking about, it is the ability of the system. System is nothing but made up with your all equipments only. Fine. So it is the ability of the system or the ability of the network working under such conditions where your voltage sag is below your minimum write through capability. Right. So what does this particular line talks about? The vulnerability is the ability of a network continuing to provide key services during random failures or intentional attacks. Fine. So the concept of this area of vulnerability has been developed to evaluate the sensitivity of the equipment being subjected to your voltage lower than the minimum voltage sag write through capability. So I have just now explained the same concept. So now the question comes, what is this minimum voltage sag write through capability? Okay, what does it mean? It means it is the immunity of the equipment, okay, that it can withstand that minimum voltage which the system is experiencing. So that is what we talk about. What is this particular term means? What is minimum voltage sag write through capability? So this term is defined as the minimum voltage magnitude that a piece of equipment can withstand or tolerate without any misoperation or failures. Okay, so that is what we are talking, that is a minimum voltage which equipment can withstand. And right now we are talking about the area of vulnerability where the system has gone below that lower limit and still the equipment is working fantastically. Fine, so that is what we are talking about, the whole concept of this particular topic, named as area of vulnerability. So this is also called as voltage sag immunity. That is the immunity of the equipment to sustain the voltage sag below the limit, below its lower limit, you know, or the susceptibility limit. So that is your equipment voltage sag immunity or equipment susceptibility limit. So if to understand this voltage area of vulnerability, we'll just take one example. So, you know, just take this particular example where you can see, just let me take a point. Okay. So you have a transmission end and you have a distribution end. So you can check over here. So this is, since this pick is from an international book, so they have followed a 13.8 kV. But in an Indian scenario, it is going to be somewhere around 11 kV. You know, so whether it is 11 kV or 13 kV, 13.8 kV, we are basically trying to say this is our distribution end and this is your transmission end. So if the fault, if for an example, we have taken two cases where we are talking about the motor contactors. So if there is any fault, okay, so the motor contactors, in the area of vulnerability for the motor contactors is shown by your this particular area. You know, so this particular area is where the this particular area is exposed to this particular fault, and beyond this area, nothing will happen to the system. You know, here the in this particular area, the all the connected loads will experience that sag inside this area. But outside this area, if any load is connected, whether at the transmission end or at the distribution end, will not experience the sag due to the fault in this particular area. Fine. Similarly, if we talk about this ASDs, then you can check out these ASD. The speed drives are having a little bit more larger area. So the outer area talk about this ASDs. So they have, if the fault occurs due to them, so their area is a bit bigger. So this is what we are trying to talk about, the area of vulnerability for ASDs and motor contractors. So this is what another best way of explaining you the term of area of vulnerability, and how do you determine that? So you determine by the total circuit miles which is exposed, you know, to the faults that can cause voltage magnitudes at the end user facility to drop below the minimum voltage sag right through capability. So this is what exactly I have told you. I hope it is clear. So it is the total area which is exposed to the fault. Fine. So it's for in case of a motor contactors, I repeat, this is the area which is exposed to the fault, and this area which is exposed to the fault will cause a dip in a voltage at the end users, okay, where it may go below to the minimum write through capability of the equipments. Fine. So the loads will be subjected to faults on both the transmission system and distribution system. So your fault can take place at the transmission, because your loads can be connected at the transmission end, or it can also be connected in the distribution end. So but how do you calculate the total one? So the actual number of voltage sags that a facility can expect is determined by combining both the area of vulnerability with the expected fault performance for this portion of power system. So what basically you are talking about, that actual number of fault a facility can expect, you know, the total number of fault in this particular area. How do I know how many number of faults will happen? So what we are trying to say, the actual number of faults that particular of voltage sags can happen in that particular area will be determined by combining the area of vulnerability plus what with the expected fault performance for this portion of power system. Because how do you get the question comes, how do I get the expected fault performance? So this expected fault performance, you will be getting it from historical data. You know, you are we know that this particular area is prone to single line to ground fault, or it is more prone to three line to ground fault. Okay, so that there is some historical data and the pattern of the fault which is happening in this particular area. So keeping that pattern in your mind, plus the area of vulnerability, will help you to actually find out how many number of sags, voltage sags, will take place. So the expected fault performance is usually determined by historical data, just now I've told you. Now, equipment sensitivity to voltage. Very important thing. Whenever the voltage sag happens, it directly reflects on the equipments. You know, whether your equipment is going to sustain this voltage sag or it is going to trip. You know, whenever there's a question of trip, that means, as we have discussed in the last lecture, a big industries people are going to face an economic loss. Or if you are working something, you can lose data. You know, so that's why the system should be designed such that interruptions are minimal. So to keep that thing in mind, the sensitivity of the equipment plays a very, very important role. So for that, equipment with an end user facility may have a different sensitivity to the voltage sets. So every equipment may have a different sensitivity to the, some equipment may trip, some equipment may be able to withstand that. So that's why I'll come to the next slides and where I'll explain that exactly how this sensitivity of the equipments can be calculated. You know, so the equipment sensitivity of a voltage sat is very dependent on this. What are the factors which affects the sensitivity of the equipment? That is first thing, the type of the sat you are facing it, and what are the types of sats? That also I'll come in my next slides. So that the kind of specific loading you have on the system, you have the type of controlling systems which are present in the system, and what type of applications it is being used. So fine. So it says that equipment sensitivity to voltage sag is very depending on the specific load type, the control settings, and the applications. Consequently, it is often difficult to identify, you know, the characteristics of a voltage sag for which the equipment will misoperate. Fine. So it's very difficult to tell exactly. If you don't have the estimation, then it's very difficult to find out exactly what is the fault point where the equipment is going to trip. So the most commonly used characteristics, so what I have to keep it in mind, the majority equipments which are fail to operate, or the equipments are more prone to, or while designing the sensitivity of the equipment, the two things which I should keep it in mind, the two characteristics, the first thing is the magnitude of the sag, and second thing is the duration of the sag. So these are the two major reasons for which equipments are sensitive towards, you know. Apart from this also, we have a lot of other things. So few applications based on these characteristics only, we define, you know, we classify it into different types of equipments. So now what happens, apart, as I told you, the main two things, the most commonly characteristics are the duration of the sag and the magnitude of the sag. Apart from this, what are the other characteristics which can affect the equipment sensitivity? That is your phase angle jump. Your angle has been shifted from your fundamental phase values, you know. So that is your phase angle jump. Then we see the three-phase unbalance, you know, voltage unbalance between three phases, and then point exactly where the voltage has, the sag has been triggered, and where it is exactly, you know, it has been, sag has gone out, you know, so off. So that is the point. These are the few characteristics which can also affect the sensitivity of the equipments, but the major is the duration and the magnitude. So keeping all these things in mind, so this, the sensitivity of the equipment for the voltage sags are divided or classified into these categories. So number one category, the equipments which are sensitive for only the magnitude of the voltage sags. So these are the particular category of the equipments which we are talking about. They are very sensitive towards the voltage sag. So this group of equipments are especially the relays, process controls, motor drive controls, and many types of automated machines. You know, mainly we talk about automated machines means we are talking about semiconductor manufacturing equipment for one of the examples. So these devices are having a minimum limit, you know, beyond which they will fail to work, and they can be very sensitive towards, since we are talking about, they are very sensitive towards the magnitude of the voltage sag. So whether the magnitude goes below the minimum limit or above the maximum limit, which we call it as a voltage swell. Okay, so these equipments will you know, fail to operate in such conditions. So they are very much sensitive towards the magnitude of the voltage sags. So in this equation, in this type of equipments, duration doesn't matter. You know, duration doesn't matter how long it's going to be there, but the magnitude, how the what will be the voltage dip, the magnitude of the voltage dip matters a lot. That is the first category. Second category, we'll see where the equipment is depending on both magnitude as well as the duration. So these are majorly all power electronic devices. As I told you before in the last lecture, the majority power quality problems are coming due to this power electronic devices. So these are the devices which really are very sensitive towards the magnitude as well as the duration. So you can just check this, such equipment misoperates or fails when the power supply outages or drops below specified values, as well as they are also affected by the duration it is going to be there. So the important characteristics for this type of equipment is the duration, that the RMS voltage is below a specified threshold at which the equipment trips. So they are very much particular about the magnitude and duration. Beyond the minimum value, this type of equipments are going to trip. The third category, which is not very much sensitive about the magnitude and duration, but the other factors. So what are the other factors? Just now we have, I have told you that the other factors can be a phase angle jump, can be unbalanced voltage conditions, or the point where the sag starts and the where the sag stops. You know, so these are the, there are some equipments which are very much affected or sensitive toward these particular characteristics of voltage sag. Fine, so these characteristics are more subtle than magnitude and duration, and their impacts are much more difficult to generalize. So since they are not very oftenly, these characteristics are seen in the equipment, and if the some equipments are facing such kind of, they're too much sensitive about this type of, you know, the characteristics of voltage sag, then it is very difficult to generalize them, you know, exactly how the equipment is going to operate or how the system is going to operate. Or react. So as a result, RMS variation performance indices defined here are focused on the more common magnitude and care. So whatever we are going to talk about, since the magnitude and the duration are the most commonly characteristics for which the equipments are more sensitive towards. So the further studies also will be keeping these two things in mind is carried out. Fine, so these loads are generally be impacted for a very short duration. We know that if there's any type of faults, they are for a very short duration usually. Okay, and virtually all voltage sags. So wherever the fault has taken place and that has affected a particular area where it has been exposed to, and that it will be there for a few cycles. You know, that conditions will last for a few cycles, because within that system is beautifully designed, and system will be restore its normal voltage within few cycles. Fine, so one of the most common methods to quantify the equipment susceptibility, that is the immunity of the equipment to voltage sag, if I have to quantify that, what is the method which I was exactly talking about you, that how do I know that my equipment is sensitive enough to withstand this minimum write through capability, you know? That for that we use a magnitude duration plot, because magnitude and duration are the major two characteristics which is affecting the sensitivity of the equipment. So how does this curve look like? So when you look, take this curve, you know, so now you look at this curve. So here you can see something is called as a CBMA curve. So this CBMA curve, this is actually a computer business equipment manufacturing team, which has been started keeping the capability of the computers to withstand such kind of voltage sags. Okay? So it has been started around 1970, and this particular organization has been further modified in 1994, which is calling as ITIC. Okay, so Information Technology Industry Council. So this is the team, which is nothing but the modified version of CBME, has been come with a much more expanded version of the CBMA, and comes out with this particular line. You can see it. So that is being, so these are all help you to the, you know, the characteristics of, identify the characteristics of the equipment sensitivity. So if it is below this level, the system will operate fantastically. If it goes beyond the boundary, then the system fails to, you know, the systems below this, like for an example, I will show you over here. We were talking about the area of vulnerability by keeping the motor contactors and ASDs in mind. So you can see the motor contactor line is this. Okay, just follow the pointer. This is your motor contactor capability, that is your curve. So this curve defines what, anything which falls below this. Below this means what is this? This is a 50, that means 0.5 per unit. So if anything falls below this 0.5 per unit, it'll stop, okay, it'll trip. Anything above this 0.5 unit, the system will work fine. So that is the sensitivity of these equipments, which can, and this effect will be only under the area of you know, vulnerability. After that area which boundary we have made, this dip in the voltage will not affect that outside that area of vulnerability, right? So that is in case of motor contactors. Similarly, you can see in case of ASDs, okay? So these ASDs, you can check, this is the curve of, that is your magnitude duration curve goes like this. And anything that is, I'm talking about 90, that means 0.9 per unit. So these are very sensitive devices. You know, so they are very, if, even if you come below 0.9 per unit, they'll trip. So if ASDs are falling below 0.9 per unit, experiencing a voltage sag below 0.9 per unit, this will trip, above which it will work. So this is the area which talks about, this is the area where the system will trip. Fine, below 0.9 per unit will trip, below 0.5 per unit this will trip. So this particular characteristics of CBMA and ITSC curves helps to understand the power, we usually call them a power quality performance curve, you know, so they are help you to understand the capability of the system to withstand the voltage sag. Fine, so this one of the most common methods to quantify equipment susceptibility to voltage sag is using a magnitude duration plot. So this is called as magnitude duration plot. It shows the voltage sag magnitude that will cause equipment to misoperate as a function of the sag duration. So here duration also matters. You know, whether it is going to go for 5 cycles, because x-axis talks about a duration. Y-axis talks about the nominal voltage, which is in RMS form. Fine, so here whether it is duration for 4 cycles, whether it's going to exist for 1 cycle, this also, so you will get the magnitude as well as the duration. Both you'll get in one plot. And if your curve is within that, it will operate, or if whether it will operate or it will trip, or it will, or the system will work fine, very easily can be find out for this from this particular curve. Okay, so next we see about transmission system sag performance evaluation. So we are going to do the sag performance because, as I told you before, the load can be connected at the transmission end and it also can be connected at distribution end. Now the question comes, if the load is connected at transmission end, that means the customers which are connected from the transmission end will experience a voltage sag if the only from the transmission end faults, you know. So if the customer is experiencing a sag, that sag, voltage sag, is only due to the fault or any misoperation at the transmission end only. But in the same place, if the customers are connected at the distribution end, which is a majorly all the loads are connected at the distribution end, that is your utility end. So in that case, if the customer side is facing any voltage sag, that will be due to the fault at the distribution end plus also the transmission end. Anything goes wrong in transmission end, our distribution side is going to, utility end is going to see that sag. Either, and if there is a happening anything wrong in the substation end, then also the utility, the customers are going to see the same dip in voltage. So what we mean to say, it's a very simple logic. If you are connected at the transmission end, that it will be, the voltage sag will be only due to the fault at transmission lines. But if you are connected at the distribution end, then the voltage sag will be maybe due to your transmission end and also due to your distribution end. Fine. So that is what these first three lines talk about. So the voltage sag performance for a given customer facility will depend on whether the customer is supplied from the transmission system or from the distribution system. For a customer supplied from the transmission system, the sag performance will depend on only the transmission system fault alone. If the system is, if your customer is connected on the other end, then it will be depend on fault performance on both transmission and distribution systems. Now let us check what is the procedure to estimate this transmission system contribution to the overall voltage sag performance at the facility. Fine, so what is the contribution? The fault happens at the transmission end. What is its contribution at the voltage sag at the other end? So, you know, there it will not be much of difference as you, the whole system is interconnected. Your power system is completely interconnected. So you may not face a momentary loss. You will only face a momentary dip, but you will not face a momentary loss as your system is completely interconnected. So as it says, transmission line faults and subsequent opening of the protected device rarely cause an interruption for any customer because of the interconnected nature of the power system. And these faults do, however, cause a voltage sag. So that's what I told you. Depending on the equipment sensitivity, second factor, it's very important. It also matters that how sensitive your equipment towards the voltage sag. So depending on the equipment sensitivity, the unit may trip off, resulting in substantially momentary loss. So when I say the system is interconnected and there is chances of interruptions, momentary interruptions are very less, you know, because everything is interconnected. If this is not working, you are getting supply from some another line. But that also matters that how sensitive your equipment towards the voltage sag. So if equipment is very sensitive towards the voltage sag, then it will trip and definitely you will face a momentary loss of supply. Fine. So the ability to estimate the expected voltage sag at the end user location is therefore very, very important. So we should, that these are the reasons which make us to, you know, it's very important to know what will be the exactly voltage sag at the other end. So most utility have detailed, so now how to estimate, the question comes, how do I estimate this voltage sag? For that you have a you know, software package, which it is called as an online programmer, that is Aspen OneLiner. So they use this kind of a system, software system, which will help you to know what are the equipments which are getting affected due to the fault at a particular location. Not only that, you can inject the fault on a particular bus bar, and whether it's a single line to ground fault, you know, line to line fault or 3LG fault, you can just create the faults and check the area of vulnerability. What are the equipments? What is the line which is exposure to this particular fault taking place at a particular point? Fine, so this particular model, that is your Aspen OneLiner, will help to find out that. Fine, so these programs can calculate the voltage throughout the system resulting from faults around the system. So this will help you to estimate, you know, exactly if I'm taking a fault at this particular bus bar. For an example, if the fault has taken place at the transmission endpoint and I want to know exactly at the customer end, at the facility end, what is the voltage getting affected? So you can exactly use the same program, create the fault at that particular bus bar, whether you want to create a fault at the transmission end or you create the fault at the distribution end. Check out the voltage at your facility end and you can just find out, yes, this is what going to happen at the facility end. So you can keep the facility and equipment sensitive enough to withstand those particular faults. Fine. So many of them cause, or many of them can also apply faults. And this is what I told you, you can apply the faults and just take out the results. The area of vulnerability describes all the fault locations that can cause equipment to misoperate. The type of fault must also be considered in this analysis. Fine, so the characteristics at the end equipment also depend on how the voltages are changed. Yes, very important. It's also very important that if there is anything going wrong, the characteristics, how the equipments are sensitive towards, that also depends on your transformer connections. You know, the how the equipment is connected, that is the equipment is connected to the face to ground or face to face, how the equipments are connected, plus how the transformers are connected on the another end. So we'll talk about this also in the graph. So now this is what that Aspen programmer I was talking about. So this is an example of transmission system in a short circuit program for calculating area of vulnerability. So you can see that you have a you know, the various type of faults which you can apply into a particular bus bar. And you can check the voltage, output voltage. This is your system. You create the fault at one particular bus and check the output at another bus. So we have a lot of software nowadays to check all these kind of conditions. This is one of the software. It's not the only software. This is one of the software which will help to find out the area of vulnerability. Now this is what I was talking about, the, you know, secondary of the you know, this is the transformer connections. So these are all your primary connections and these are your secondary connections. So now what here we are trying to say is your primary connection, we are going to apply an SLG fault, a single line to ground fault at the primary end, and you are going to check the voltage, that is your phase to phase voltage and phase to neutral voltage at the secondary end. That is what we are going to do it. So this particular the table, it's all talk about the connections of your transformer and the output what transformer delivers you. Phase to phase voltage, how does that be? There's a fault at the primary end of the transformer. How does my secondary end voltage drops down? So you can check out the secondary end voltage is how it's coming. VAB is 0.58. And when I talk about a single line, because this table only talks about a single line to ground fault, and we take it as assume that the line A has experienced that fault A. So line A to ground, there is an SLG happened. SLG fault has happened. Okay, so how the secondary end voltages are going to, affected by the fault at the primary end. So these are your phase to phase voltages of all these type of connections, and this is your phase to neutral. So what here you check is if your connection is like this delta and star, delta star transformer, then you find that your secondary side will never experience a zero voltage. This table relationship illustrates the fact that a single line to ground fault on the primary of a delta star grounded transformer does not result in zero voltage. This is what I'm talking about, this particular case. So if your primary is delta and secondary is star, this does not give you zero voltage either phase to phase or phase to neutral, right? The magnitude of the lowest secondary voltage depends on how the equipment is connected, how your equipment is connected. That's how you can find out the magnitude of your lowest voltage. So, and if you look at this particular table, you can see that the phase to phase, if the fault has occurred at line A at the primary end, the phase to phase lowest value is 0.33. You know, so the lowest voltage which will drop down is to 0.33 per unit. Whereas line to neutral, if you check, here also you get once 0.33, but we normally take it as a 0.58, 58%, you know. So major effect is here, but here major effect is 0.33. So the magnitude of the lowest secondary voltage depends on how the equipment is connected. So we have seen how the transformer is connected. Now this also matters how the equipment is also connected. Fine, so the equipment connected line to line would experience a minimum voltage of 33%. And the equipment that is your, the transformer, which is an equipment connected line to neutral volt would experience a minimum voltage of 58%, just now which I have told you. So what does it explains you? This explaining the importance of both the transformer connections and the equipment connection is determine the actual voltage that equipment will experience during a fault. Fine. So if I am creating a fault condition at the transformer primary, my transformer secondary is going to experience the dip in the voltage, and that dip in the voltage will be experienced by my equipment at the facility end. So the equipment or at the facility end also depends on the connection, the equipment, the type of connection the equipment is, whether it's the equipment is connected phase to phase or it is connected phase to neutral. So the connection of the equipment also plays a major role the way it is connected, fine? So we have seen this particular condition. So now there is another factor, there's a Matt Bullen. He has invented the different types of SATs, based on the classification where the, which particular phase is getting, whether all the three phases are experiencing the dip or a single phase is experiencing or the two phases are experiencing the dip, based on the number of phases are experiencing a dip or based on the phase differences at a particular, for whether all the three phases are also having a phase shift or only the two phases are having a phase shift. Keeping all this criteria in mind, Matt Bullen has categorized this voltage sag into five different types. I'll show you in the next slide. So there are five types that are commonly being experienced, and these false types can be used to conveniently summarize the expected performance at a customer location for different types of faults of the supply system. This different type of category will help you to understand exactly what the system is going through, okay, the type of sag. So now here you look at the type of sags. So the type A, type B, type C, type D, and type E. So these are the type of sags. So now look at the type A sag. I'll start with the type A sag. Type A sag shows that all the three phases have experienced a dip in the voltage. Okay, it's a balanced system we are taking about. So all the this balanced conditions, all of them are facing a dip in the voltage, but they don't have any phase shift. Okay, so there is no phase shift in any one of the phases, but all have experienced the same sort of dip. Then it comes under a type A sat. Coming to a type B sat, what happens? Only a single phase has experienced the dip. Other two phases are nominal value. Other two phases are maintaining the fundamental value, but only one particular phase is experiencing the dip and there is no phase shift. Fine, so that is your type B. Whereas you go for a type D talks about that there is a dip in, actually there is a dip in all the three, but the dip in other two phases are very minimal, but the dip in one single phase is a lot. Okay, it has been, there is a voltage sag much in this particular phase, but this particular phase doesn't experience a voltage phase jump, but here there is a phase jump in these two cases. Fine, so this kind of sags will come under type D. Coming to a type C where one is following the nominal fundamental waveform, other two have experienced the sag including the phase shift also. So that is coming under type C. So these five different types, sags. So at the end, equipment will help us to understand the kind of, the performance of the equipment under voltage sag. So now, as this, showed you that the software, with the help of the software, where you can find out the area of vulnerability. So this table, you can get it as output where it can show you the fault which has been created at a particular bus bar. And this bus bars are, since it is an international book, this table is taken from an international book. So this are taken from that particular, the bus bar name has been given as Tennessee, Nevada, Texas. So these are the bus bars name. So this is a faulted bus at this particular area. And this, if a three line to ground fault has been created at this particular bus bar, and this bus bar actual voltages are 132 volt, but the voltage monitored at particular where you want to monitor the voltage, you can see the effect of the voltage, the dip in the voltage. So when you create at this particular bus bar, you're finding is zero. When you're creating at this three, so you can see that the line is exposed to what distance, the fault is affecting up to what distance. So this is the bus which you are noticing the effect of these faults, different types of faults at different bus bars. And these all will give you also not only the dip in the voltage, but also will categorize the type of sags. Okay, so this kind of data will help you to analyze the effect of the system due to the voltage sag. So basically the sag has been created at this end around below 80%, and then only this output has been taken. And the actual performance is then determined by combining the area of vulnerability with the expected number of faults within this area of vulnerability, which I already told you. So in the first slides only, we have learned about the total expected performance can be determined by the area of vulnerability plus the expected number of faults which has already occurred in this area with the help of historical data. So the fault performance is usually described in terms of 100 miles per year. So how many times in 100 miles per year, how many faults have taken place? What are the characteristics of the faults? So it is mainly keeping this thing in mind. This is the way of taking it. Most utilities maintain statistics of fault performance at all different transmission voltages. And this system wide statistics can be used along with the area of vulnerability to estimate the actual expected voltage sag performance as your second point. Same thing has been told here. Fine. Now, this is the curve plot, which will help you to understand, the sag performance at the load end. So you can see the x-axis talks about the equipment sensitivity and the y-axis talks about the total trips per year, because usually the data will be given per year basis. So how many trips will happen due to the, the voltage, the equipment sensitivity. So if you can see that the majority, you can see that this is sag type A. That means all the three phases are experiencing the same type of dip. Fine. So it is, the total number of trips are almost near to 23, 24 trips per year, happening only due to the of TAPS SAG A, and where the sensitivity of the equipment, you are able to keep it around 50%, you know. So these are the graphs which will help you to understand the complete picture of the whole system. Okay, it gives you. So it shows the expected number of voltage sags per year at the customer equipment due to transmission system faults. Fine. And this is, the performance is broken down into different sag types, because the equipment sensitivity may be different for sags that affect all the three phases versus sags that only affect one phase, single phase, or two phases. So this will help you that how many equipments are getting are sensitive towards a single phase fault, or you know, the sags which are affecting a single phase, the two phase, or all the three phases. So this will help us to identify that. Now we are coming to, so far we have seen the sag performance at the transmission level. Now we'll see the sag performance at the utility level. Fine. So the utility level, what happens? Customers that are supplied at distribution voltage levels are impacted by faults on both transmission and distribution system. We have already discussed. So the analysis at the distribution level must also include, you know, so when you talk about, as we have told you, that when the fault is at the distribution level, it depends on whether the fault has happened at the same feeder, you know, or it has happened at the parallel feeder. I hope you have seen the lecture one, and there we have already discussed about it. So I just repeat that the fault at the utility end can happen at the same feeder, or it can happen at the parallel feeder. So I hope you remember that if it happens at the parallel feeder, then the chances of getting interruption is very, very less. You know, the facility at this particular feeder will experience a voltage sag, but may not experience an interruption. But if the fault has happened at the same feeder where you are connected to, then you may also experience a momentary interruptions. So that means when you are coming towards a calculation of the utility end, you required a calculation for the voltage, number of the voltage sags, that is your, the minimum voltage. You need to estimate the minimum voltage beyond which the system will trip, and also the you know, the interruption time period. So the interruption voltage, the voltage beyond which the system will trip, that also is very, very required. So it says the analysis at distribution level must also include momentary interruptions caused by operation of protective devices to clear the fault. So you also, you have two factors over here. One is the your calculation for or estimating for the voltage sag, and plus the estimating for your momentary interruptions. So two things comes under utility distribution system. Fine. So here what we do is we take a system, as I told you. So here you have the feeders. So if you all these things, you know, this is a typical distribution system with multiple feeders. You have, you have the fuse lateral bar branches, you have the line bleed closures. So getting interruptions, system getting interrupted is very rare, because your system is, even if it is there, it will be there for few cycles. So the utility here, whatever the, you know, protective scheme you have, it plays a very, very important role. You know, how fast your system restore its original voltage or come back to its nominal voltage, it depends on the scheme which you are applying at your distribution end. So the critical information, yes. So what are the information I need? What are the very vital information which is required to calculate these values? So that is your number of feeders supplied from the, how many feeders are connected to your substations? What are the average length of these feeders? What is the reactance value? What is the short circuit equivalent reactance at the substations? What is your feeder reactor? And then the average feeder fault performance, means how many faults has happened on an average on that particular substations, whether you talk about an SLG fault or you talk about or a 3LG fault, fine. So these are the major points which need to be in mind when we compute for voltage sag performance. Okay, I repeat, that is the number of feeders connected to your substation. Second, the average feeder length, then your average feeder reactance, then feeder reactors. If you have connected and you required any feeder reactors, then you have to consider that. If you have not connected, then you just leave it. Then you have a short circuit equivalent reactance. Then the number of faults in history, in the previous cases, which you have a data which says so many number of LG and you know, as a 3LG and SLG fault has taken place. So there are two possible locations, just now which I have discussed here. There are two possible locations where the fault can happen at this distribution end. One is at the parallel feeder or at the same feeder. So what happens, we'll just check. So whether it happens at the same feeder or a parallel feeder, an area of vulnerability defining the total circuit miles which are exposed to these faults, okay, cause the voltage sags below equipment sag right through capability at a specific customer needs to be defined. So at the customer end, whether the fault has happened at the same feeder or the fault has happened at the parallel feeder, the area of vulnerability is the area which exposes and talks about that here, whatever the equipments are connected, should, what is the minimum voltage limit beyond which the equipment will trip, okay? Or beyond which or below which, because when we talk about area of vulnerability, we keep it in mind that below that minimum sag through point, capability point, also system is working fine. So I want to know what is that minimum beyond which the system can still work, healthy. System is still healthier, or system is working without any interruption. So faults on parallel feeders. So first we'll talk about parallel feeders, then we'll go about the series, you know. So if the fault has taken in your parallel feeder, then what happened? The facility will experience a dip, not the interruption. So I need to calculate that expected voltage magnitude at that substation. So if I know what is the dip in the voltage at the substation, I can easily estimate what is the dip in the equipment level at the facility end. So now what happens over here? The voltage magnitude at the substation is impacted. What are the things which impact the voltage magnitude at the substation? So first is your fault impedance, then is your location, then is the how your power system has been configured, and what is your protection schemes. So these are the things which literally affect the voltage at the substation. So the figure illustrates that. I'll show you this figure. So this is the figure which talks about, you know, the characteristics at a single line to ground fault happening and three phase fault. So what is that? What is this characteristics basically talk about? This talks about with the relationship between what is the distance of the fault from your substation. When I'm talking about that, the voltage at the facility, the dip in the voltage at the facility end depends on the dip in the voltage at the substation end, then it's very important that where, which is the fault location, and that location of the fault is how far from your substation, because that does affect. So that is the fault location and the type of fault which has experienced. So type of the fault is taken care over here, single line to ground fault, and this is your three phase fault. This shows the distance from your fault location to your substation. And this gives you phase AB voltage, the percent of phase AB voltage, it has shown the variation. Fine. So this is the typical graph which has plotted, and this particular graph will help you to find out what is the exact voltage dip at the facility end you can estimate, you can expect. So the voltage sag performance for a specific sensitive. Now, if I have to determine the voltage sag performance at a sensitive equipment, which is having a minimum write through voltage of VS. So if I take the VS as the minimum write through, you know, beyond which the system will trip, okay? So if I take the voltage sag performance for a specific sensitive equipment having the minimum write through voltage of VS can be computed. So what is that point which you want to calculate is with the help of this equation. So this VS can also be represented as E parallel, because this will help you to understand that you are calculating the dip in the voltage at the facility end due to the fault in your parallel feeder, fine? So you say that is an N1 into EP1 plus N3 into EP3. So what is N1 and N3? N1 and N3 are your data related to your single line to ground fault, and this is 3LG fault. So these are data related to your SLG, and this is 3LG fault. What is your EP and EP3? This is the area which is exposed, okay? for this particular fault. So EP1 is the area exposed for your SLG fault, and this is your area exposed in miles in case of a 3LG fault. Fine. So you can see here where N1 and N3 are fault performance data for SLG and 3LG faults in faults per mile per month. And EP1 and EP3 are the total circuit miles exposure to SLG and 3LG faults on parallel feeders that results in voltage sags below the minimum write-through voltage VS at the end user location. So these will help me to tell that below this point, you know, the system is it is at risk, you know, it is going to be tripped. So it will help me to find out this is the point beyond which the system may trip. Faults on the same feeder. So, you know, when the question of fault on the same feeder, then I'll have a concept of voltage sag as well as I'll have concept of interruptions because there may be a momentary loss of supply. So what happens? The expected voltage sag magnitude at the end user location is computed as a function of fault location on the same feeder. So however, computation is performed only for fault location at present that will result in a sag, but will not result in a momentary interruption. So momentary interruption will take it later. We'll first take the sag. Okay. So the example of such fault location includes faults beyond a, you know, reclosure time or whatever the coordinator you have with other breakers. So we will take everything into picture and then only we will calculate. So the voltage sag performance. So how do I calculate that minimum write through capability of the equipment VS with the help of this equation? So this is the voltage sag, the minimum write through voltage VS. It is same is written for same feeder voltage. So you can write E same or you can write VS is equal to N1 into ES1 plus N3 into ES3. S is standing for same and P is standing for parallel in the previous equation. N1 stands for SLG and 3 stands for 3LG. Okay, so it's very easy to remember. That means 1 and 3 stands for SLG and 3LG. P stands for parallel, S stands for same feeder. Parallel feeder and the same feeder, other the concept remains same, okay? Now the total expected voltage sag performance. I have taken the, because you don't know the fault has been parallel or where it has happened. So now for total expected voltage sag performance for a minimum write through VS value, you will consider the effect of minimum voltage from the parallel feeder as well as from the same feeder. So you will take the sum of both the equations. So it will be E parallel plus of E same. So what I say, the sum of expected voltage sag performance on the parallel and the same feeders, that is E parallel plus of E same. So the total expected sag performance can be computed for other voltage thresholds also, which then can be plotted to produce a plot similar to the ones which we have discussed right now. Fine. So you can take a different type of faults. You can keep your thresholds as a different value and you can just follow the same procedure and just plot the graph, which will help you to understand the sensitivity of the equipment at the facility end. The expected interruptions performance at the specified location can be determined by the length of this. That's what we tell the concept of your vulnerability, area of vulnerability, okay? So the expected interruption performance at the specified location can be determined the length of exposure that will cause a breaker or other protected devices in series with the customer facility to operate. Fine, for example, now I'm going to take care of the interruption point because, you know, the, if it is at the same line, with the same feeder, there is a chances that you may go out of supply for a momentary. Fine, so what we say that expected number of interruption that can take place can be computed by, okay, that is your length of the fault where it has taken place. Fine, and that is your same thing, number of datas available in your SLG and 3LG fault. So where Lint is the total circuit miles exposure to these type of faults, results in interruptions at the end user facility. Finds the total miles which it is covering, the length of the fault to your end user with the data of your LG and 3LG faults and having, which is impacting on the interruption at the end user facility. Fine. So now it's come to a quiz time. I hope it is clear to all of you that exactly what we have studied today is very interesting. Total estimating a voltage sag performance. So we have understood the concept of area of vulnerability. Then we have studied how the equipment are sensitive towards this kind of voltage sags. What are the factors which should be keep in mind, which are mainly your magnitude and the duration, which mainly equipments are sensitive towards. And then we have seen how the disturbances which are taking place at the transmission end and the distribution end affects your load end or your facility and equipments. Fine. So based on these basic concepts, let us have some fun time. So because quiz, it's actually, it's a fun time, you know. So small, small questions which are very simple. And I'm very sure that if you have heard the whole lecture properly, then you'll be able to answer this. The dash describes all the fault locations that can cause equipment to misoperate. What is the answer? Think. I repeat, the dash describes all the fault locations that can cause equipment to misoperate. What is that? Area of vulnerability. That is what we were talking about, you know. So the area of vulnerability describes all the fault locations that can cause the your equipments to misoperate. Beyond that area, your system will work fine. That is the area which will get affected by the fault taken place at a particular location, and the affected area will be defined by that particular boundary where there are chances that equipment will fail to operate. That means they'll trip. Fine. So that is what the study of that particular area becomes so important. The most common way to calculate the voltage sag is from, what is the value which you use? You use an average value or use an RMS value? Yes, we use an RMS voltage. Next question. When the RMS voltage decreases less than 0.1 per unit for time duration of 0.833 second to 3 second, it is called as momentary interruption. Okay, when it falls below 0.1 per unit, this is what we are studying. If your system falls below 0.1 per unit, there the chances the system will, the equipment will start to misoperate. And that's how the study of that particular area where and all equipments are going, are chances of misoperating, study of that particular area is becoming very, very important. And that is what we called an area of vulnerability. You know, they are very sensitive. Though that particular area is very, very sensitive to this kind of, you know, below this fault has occurred and this particular area is very sensitive to this particular load. This particular fault. What are the different ways to estimate the voltage sag performance? Just now we studied. Number one, area of vulnerability. Number two, equipment sensitive to voltage sag. Third, transmission system and utility distribution sag performance evaluation. So these are the 3 points which will help you to estimate the voltage sag performance. Area of vulnerability is also called as equipment voltage sag immunity, equipment voltage sag susceptibility limit. Everything I have covered, I'm just recapping everything with the help of this small quiz. The minimum voltage magnitude a piece of equipment can withstand or tolerate without misoperation or failure is known as. Yes, throughout the lecture, we are just talking about that one single, few terms. What is that? Minimum write-through capability. That is your equipment minimum write-through capability. Means within this, the equipment is able to withstand beyond this particular minimum limit, there's a chance that equipment may misoperate. Okay. Okay, with this, thank you guys for hearing such a long lecture. And I'll see you again in third lecture. Take care. Bye.